So we are on book 10, and as we know, it's a long journey that has been covered through Savitri, with the help of Savitri. So Savitri, as we know, is in three parts. Part 1 is essentially the yoga of Ashwapati. It starts with tapasya of Ashwapati, ends with assurance of the Divine Mother's grace upon earth. So his tapasya is about that, how this earth can change, and he knows that the key is with the Divine Mother and her Shakti, her power, and something of her must come here. Then only this vast spiritual change can happen. Which means that to the very first fundamental step when we take to this yoga, Mother says it very beautifully in one of her writings, as long as we are pining our hopes on things that are external, on things that are based on human nature as it presently is, whether it be political, whether it be social, activism of various kinds, well, there are people who are meant to do this, but for us the hope is in the divine presence and the divine grace, which can change human nature into something more than human. If human nature remains what it is, then whatever may happen, even the best things, they will be subject to decline and fall. And that is what has happened till now. So it's a radical change. Then we have part 2, where the Divine Mother consents, she comes to earth, and it is essentially her yoga. And her yoga is to open the path for man towards this new creation. Man must walk, she has to open that path, because up till now, there are many things about this path and that path, and even now we have this tendency to put Aurobindo into this slot or that slot. But it's a path that has been opened for man through the heart door, through the psychic door, as we can see in Mother's yoga, which eventually will take him towards the great transformation envisaged by Mother and Aurobindo. And this ends with Death in the Forest, book 8. And then comes part 3, which is where we are, where the epic battle takes place. Now the strange part is, apparently this is a battle between Satyavan and Death, because Satyavan has to come back. But it's not Satyavan who fights the battle. It is the Divine Mother who fights the battle. And what is so special about Satyavan that she is fighting the battle? Of course, we are told that Satyavan is a very noble being. He is a jewel upon earth. There is no trace of meanness, selfishness, all these things in him. He is not a cynic, even though he is outcast from the kingdom. He has not joined some political group with a jhanda and says, look, he has not done any of these things. He tries to understand nature. He is a student of human nature. And in the process, he seeks and he finds glimpses and touches of the divine. He has not blamed God. He is not complaining about his situation. But his seeking has carried him to one step further. Though he is noble, he is not stuck in his nobility or within that limited framework. He seeks something beyond, and that we have been told that he is seeking the reconciliation between earth and heaven, between the self and the world, between the divine as he has glimpsed the presence in all things, and nature as we experience here. This is his seeking. And in the process, something unprecedented happens. Normally we say that we go to the path, we take to the path. But in Aurobindo's yoga, the path comes to us. So it's like a call. So we see the path comes to Satyavan. Doesn't matter where one is, he is in wilderness. And the path comes. And it comes in the form of Divine Mother as Savitri, and the moment he sees, he acknowledges, there is a soul recognition that we are the ones who have been partners for centuries, millenniums, since time began, because this is the real partnership. Together, the tournament we play against death, the human soul and the Divine Mother. So this is the recognition that takes place, and then he does something which is what is the beginning of his yoga, real beginning. He surrenders, and all that he says is, will you accept me just as I am? I have very little, you know, things to give you. Mother recounts this story of the perfect gift that a lady who gives to Shiva. Shiva comes as a Brahmin or a beggar or a mendicant. And he asks her that, do you have something to give? She says, I have half an apple, I have eaten it and it's kept. So I can give you that. And Shiva is very satisfied. And the mother adds as a footnote to the story, mind you, she did not know that he is Shiva. She didn't know that he is God who can change her life. She just had a sense that here is somebody who needs something and I have this with me, and she just gives it. That's why the mother calls it the perfect gift. It is done with no other ulterior motive. This self-giving is what Satyavan has done with regard to Savitri. And therefore, the moment that happens, from that moment onwards, life begins to change. And she takes charge of her destiny. It is no more our destiny. It is her path. It's no more our path, but her path. Someone asked the mother that we have accepted you. It's a very silly question. But he said, we have accepted you. How do we know that you have accepted me? So this question was sent to mother. Mother sent a reply through Nolnida. Many people have this question. How do we know mother has accepted us? So mother sent a very amazing reply. She said, you know, a guru can choose or not choose. He can say he is fit for being my disciple and he is not fit for being my disciple. But I am the mother. How does she say that, you know, have you accepted me? It is her creation. We are all her children. The difference is we may know it or we may not know it. We may surrender consciously. Even when we don't surrender, she leads us. Only thing is through a veil of ignorance. So this is what has happened in Satyavan's life. And then she takes the destiny and then Satyavan goes through the darkness of death. In a certain sense, this darkness is all the time surrounding us. And what is its action? It takes away hope. It takes away faith. It tends to turn us into pessimists. Then, you know, pessimists become very revolting kind of people. They want to change world as if by, by a sudden storm. But this is a process. This is a mechanism. We must understand what this world is constituted of. And mother reminds us again and again to chase away all pessimism. She says it's the tail of the devil. So if you allow his tail, then he will enter, the full thing will enter inside. So Satyavan is comfortable. He has just given himself to mother and he doesn't know that he is being carried through death, the darkness of death. And we read some beautiful lines and I'll just quickly read them. Book 9, Canto 2. Page 591, because one of the ways that this ignorance captures us is by imitating the divinity it denies. So there are human beings who deny the existence of God. Actually, they are less dangerous. They have declared their game. Their cards. And some of them may deny because they want truth and beauty upon earth. So there is even a logic behind it. As Shobindu says, agnosticism and even atheism is a corrective to a kind of religious belief. But there are some who imitate, and that is dangerous. So they say, yes, there is God, but this God is otherworldly, who has nothing to do with earth. He has nothing to do with feelings. You call him a being, there is no being out there. He is just an impersonal power. And you can go into that. So this is the image of God that death paints to Savitri. And Savitri replies, page 591, last few lines, who is this God imagined by thy night? One of the first things that the mother tells us when you step onto this yoga, you must have an integral conception of the divine. If the conception of divine is that, you know, he is otherworldly, he is far away, he is remote, then he'll be far away and remote. But if the conception is that he is an integral truth, he is constantly expressing and manifesting himself in countless ways, he is within us. It's a very powerful meditation of Sri Aurobindo where he says, it's a meditation. He says, look, who is burning yonder in the skies? in the distant galaxies, who is near us, look here in that crouching old man, in that sick person, in that child. It is he. And then he says, he is nearer to you. He is in you. And he ends up by saying, he is you. Now that great Sohamasmi. So this is the conception from which we start, that within us there is this divine presence and he is in all creation, not only within me, but also others have a right to his presence. So, contemptuously creating worlds disdained, who made for vanity the brilliant stars. So he doesn't disdain this very beautiful line when Shobindu speaks of God. Thou who disdainest not the worm to be, nor even the clod. Therefore we know by that humility that thou art God. And Mother gives the perfect example of humility is Shobindu himself. With all those realizations, how beautifully we see in 12 years, Nirodha writes, if he has to get a letter posted, he would raise his hand and say, I suppose this has to be posted. And then he writes, 100 hungry hands would grab. give me, I want to do it. He doesn't say, do it. No, he doesn't say that. He is like that, the humblest of the humble. Not he who has reared his temple in my thoughts. This is not my conception of God, who orders people, sends them to hell, makes them go to heaven if you put some laddu and ghee. That is not the God. That is like a politician. That's a God imagined by death. And that conception has been given to us. So that's not what he is. And made his sacred floor my human heart. Where is his temple? This is where I have found him. This is my God who dwells within my heart. And made his sacred floor my human heart. My God is will and triumphs in his paths. He is invincible. He is the omnipotent. And he triumphs in his paths. But what is his power? My God is love and sweetly suffers all. He accepts us just as we are and takes the burden of the flesh so that the flesh may be converted into the equivalent of the spirit. And then she says that what is the yoga she has done? Two lines she summarizes. To him I have offered hope for sacrifice. I have nothing to give. That once again I am reminded of this line of Milton. What I can give you? I have got nothing. I am blind by eye. I can't even write. And yet, this is all I can give you. So what she has given to him? Hope. And I have offered him my hope as sacrifice. And gave my longings as a sacrament. I want this earth to become divine. And this hope I have offered at thy feet, thou wouldst fulfill it. And I trust that thou wouldst do it. So this is what she brings. And as she, this gleam of hope that we have read previously, it's a very powerful passage where in that black void where nothing can be seen, even Savitri feels that everything is vanishing. Then she holds on to hope. The first weapon that she brings out to challenge death is hope. And hope is such a wonderful thing. If we can just keep this flame alive, it will change everything. And we saw recently this whole thing about the Thailand boys' rescue, that what they didn't allow to diminish was hope. Hope is something we must always keep under all circumstances. And she has kept that hope alive. And therefore, the battle goes on to the next level. And the next level is where she is shown the twilight of the gods, the heavens, which come and vanish. And we read last time that these heavens are, they exist in their own right. But at the same time, human thought has also created heavens. Like we have the story of Vishwamitra. He created a heaven for Trishanku. What it literally means is that he used the power of Trishanku's desire. He wanted to go to heaven. So he says, okay, the actual heavens refuse you. So picking the power of your thoughts and your desires, I am going to create a world in which you will live. And Trishanku goes there. And he is still stuck there. Somebody has to bring him out of that heaven because it's not a good state to be forever there. So he has gone into that heaven, and similarly there are hell of our making. Mother says that there is, hell and heaven are real and unreal at the same time. And she says there are people who believe in hell and they believe they have committed a sin and therefore they must go to hell, and they, after death, they go to hell. But this is a hell of their own making. So one person, it took her 1 year to convince him that there is no hell. He said, no, I'm a great sinner. I'm guilty. I must be in hell. So she had to, took 1 year to convince him there is no hell. It's your own making. Come out. Same way we create these beings out of ourselves and call it God, you know, conscience. So there was the story of the Buddhist lady who created a Mahatma out of herself. And this Mahatma started guiding her, telling her, do this, don't do this, this is Papa, this is Punyam. So she got very troubled. She says, he doesn't leave me free. I can't even eat properly because every time I look at a sweet and he tells you are doing a wrong thing. So she asked mother that, what should I do? Mother said, well, all that you have tried is the wrong way. What she was trying to push away the Mahatma to do something to him, says he won't go. Why? Because you have created. So what can I do? Absorb him back into yourself. It's your own creation. There is no reality in that. She says, ah, then she came and told mother, now I am finally free of this Mahatma. It's a very beautiful little story. So we create such Mahatmas and we call it, you know, guidance from God. So God is least interested in that. He changes everything by the silent power of love. That's how mother works. So he takes her through those heavens, and then as she passes by, they begin to fade away because they are created by the human thought, which is very creative and forms them. And now comes the next canto, canto 2, the gospel of death and vanity of the ideal. So this is death's philosophy. Death is a great philosopher, by the way. We shouldn't think that all philosophers are spiritual beings and divine beings. Death is a pakka philosopher. In fact, divine beings are less of a philosopher. They have love in their heart. They don't care about philosophy so much. That's why Shobhindu was not comfortable when people would call him a philosopher. He said, poet, yes. Even politics, I agree. Don't make me into a philosopher. Philosopher is a very dry as dust thing. So death is a philosopher. But you know what it tries to convince Savitri? By his reasoning, Savitri will respond at another level. And that's what we are going to see now. But first, she is giving death the full chance. You speak out. It is just in the line of every epic. We see in Ramayana, it is first Ravana who speaks. There is a whole volley of things that Ravana tells Rama. And if you see through that argument, you will, you know, one is able to see a reflection of what Shobhindu brings out in Savitri. In that argument, he brings out the same thing. That, you know, there is no God, there is no higher truth, might is right, I have Sita with me, this is the truth. And you are an incapable person, with this monkey army, you cannot attack and demolish me. The argument runs like this, essentially, to dishearten him, to fill him with pessimism. And after the whole argument is over, Rama says, all right, done, let's fight. So that's the end of the story. You have finished, now let's take the challenge. So first, death is given the chance to speak out in the cosmic assembly, the gospel of death and vanity of the ideal. Then pealed the calm, inexorable voice. He can be very calm. This calm is the calm of the dry as dust philosopher. This is not the calm of the divine spiritual calm, which is full of power. This is that a calm that comes when the heart has been crushed. When we see when Savitri says, he speaks about the fire, the sweetness, the love. This is the calm that comes when the heart has been completely crushed. That's how philosophers are made. Sorry for that. Abolishing hope. Canceling life's golden truths. Fatal its accent smote the trembling air. So basically, what is he doing? His work is one-pointed agenda, finish hope. Wherever you see hope, finish hope. One way or the other. He is attacking hope. And golden truths of life. What these golden truths are, we will see. That lovely world swam thin and frail, most like some pearly evanescent farewell gleam on the faint verge of dusk in moonless eves. So that lovely world which for a moment gave the sense of a daybreak begins to fade and pass away. And so death says, look, you saw that heaven, how it has vanished. Once again it is night. This is the truth. So in yoga also this happens. Good moments are followed by dips. And that's when these powers attack with fullness and fury. And mother says, that time we must remember. That's what we see in Savitri when Narada says, because the dark body of the atheist knows him not, must the sage too deny the light. So these moments come. That time we have to remember that no, this is not the truth. The truth is what my soul has experienced in that one moment. So what does he say? Prisoner of nature, many-visioned spirit, thought's creature in the ideal's realm enjoying, thy unsubstantial immortality. This subtle, marvelous mind of man has feigned. This is the world from which thy yearnings come, from which thy yearnings came. So he says, I know human beings, they are all the time dreaming about love and light and divinity and truth, immortality. But I know there is no substance in it. This is the world which they time to time glimpse and they start dreaming. But I demolish it. And then he'll give many examples. Look how I demolish it. I finish it. You believe it is true? It's not true. Like this, heaven has faded away from your sight. All this idealism will one day vanish. Now the beauty of his speech is, he is actually speaking truth, but half truth. There can be nothing more dangerous than that. Because it takes the garb, you know, that's why truth, when it is used as a weapon of falsehood, it's most deceptive. That's what he is going to do. It is being used as a weapon to perpetuate falsehood. When it would build eternity from the dust, man's thought paints images, illusion rounds. Professing glories it shall never see, it labors delicately among its dreams. So he says, you know, even now you'll see many people who will say, oh, new world, supramental world, we don't know, I don't see. Mother clarified, it'll take thousands of years, oh my God, too much. When you look, millions of years we have passed wandering on earth, 1,000 years actually looks so close. Thousands of years, oh no, oh it is not true, it cannot be. So that is the way it starts attacking the human mind. Behold this fleeing of light-tasseled shapes, aerial raiment of unbodied gods. Nobody, this love never took a shape on human earth. It's there just as a feeling. Like people use these words nowadays, rhetorics and, you know, airy-fairy, their dreams. This is the concrete reality. You know, when people come, it used to happen earlier, now it doesn't. Come to India and they would take images. And you know, what is India? Bhuke Nange Log. It's nothing but people who are malnourished, starving, and you know, they are naked. The beauty is very strange. This is my own observation. The beauty is that in India, this, maybe I'm biased, but even a most Bhuka Nanga child has a joy on his face. It's strange. And you know, grown up in a village amidst very modest surroundings, we were so happy. And somebody could have well taken a picture and said Bhuka Nanga. But I know every moment was such a joy, which is so difficult to find when you, even in big palaces outside, it's just something which we get as a gift, gift of grace. Unless our minds get corrupted, it's spontaneous. It's like a gift. And I believe every child has got it. But somehow it is there. I have seen this difference in even an Indian cow and the cows elsewhere. We don't know. You know, and this was confirmed to me by none else but Chotnaranji. He said, yes, yes, I have made the same observation. There's something so beautiful about them. So look into the eyes. I'm not saying, do this experiment and you'll see the difference. Something so beautiful, something which is just given as a gift. So anyways, that's not the subject. But the subject is, he's saying these are all dreams. They cannot be. A rapture of things that never can be born. Hope chants to hope, a bright immortal choir. Cloud satisfies cloud. Phantom to longing phantom leans sweetly. Sweetly is clasped or sweetly chased. He says, this is all phantom. This is all like clouds. You see images in the clouds. Even there is a picture of it called pareidolia. Recently somebody sent me an image of the Auroville fire on, I think, 20th night. And so beautiful, actually, that fire, that image at least that I have got, it looks like the form, actually it looks to me the form of the Divine Mother. But I know if psychiatrists will say that, you know, you are seeing it's an illusion. Actually, it's nothing, it's just a fire. Why are you seeing a form? It's called pareidolia. You see in cloud images. So death is saying there is no such reality. You are seeing reality where none is there. Your mind is painting it. Now, again, all these are truths, but half-truths. If you see from an evolutionary point of view, ideally is a brilliant shadow given to man to keep his journey going because he's not yet ready for that truth. You know, when if you read Queen Hatsheput's charter of the Sun Temple, which is now in ruins, but the charter remains, it just reads like the charter of Auroville. And we know it was Mother's, one of her previous incarnations. And when Mother was asked that, you know, that time itself, there was a conception. She said, yes. So, but Auroville was not to be that time. So, why was it kept? So, she says, it was known that this is not the time for it to manifest. But the mind of the race, in the memory of the race, this truth had to be preserved. So, it was given to man that there is this truth. When it will happen, obviously, that was not Auroville, but, you know, the Sun Temple in which this charter is given. So this ideal is given, like, you know, adolescent, this ideal is given as a prop, a clutch. But when we say that this is the ultimate and there is nothing beyond, then we make a mistake. Because it will break. If we try to build it with the power of the mind, it won't work out. Its builder is thought, its base the heart's desire, but nothing real answers to their call. So this idealism can never be created by the power of thought and the desire of the heart. This is true. But it doesn't mean it can never be created. There is a greater power which can rebuild it. But that power, death doesn't know naturally. And he has to be slowly disclosed. That power has to be disclosed to him. The ideal dwells not in heaven, nor on the earth. Then he says, look, read your stories of the Puranas. Look at gods, extremely jealous fellows. You are talking of ideal. Even they don't know how to love. And Mother says something very beautiful. When this story of Anusuya was shown, where all the gods have turned into babies, Mother laughed and laughed. She was very happy with the story. She said, it's true that only human beings can love like that. Even gods cannot love. And she had a very simple answer. She said, because human beings contain in them a representative of the supreme, there is the psychic in human beings. The gods don't have it, so they don't know how to love. When they have to learn how to love, they have to take a human body. Then they know what it means to love. This is the greatness of humanity. But they don't know. So he's saying, you know, look at heaven, your Puranas. And he starts quoting them because he's a very well-read. All death philosopher, they are very, very well-read fellows. They have all done, you know, Harvard University degrees. And then they write on Mahabharata and Ramayana and say it is nothing but, you know, Freudian theory. Well, they are very well-read fellows after all, you know, very highly qualified. So, the ideal dwells not in heaven, nor on the earth. A bright delirium of man's ardor of hope, drunk with the wine of its own fantasy. It is a brilliant, shadows, dreamy trail. So he passes a judgment, but he doesn't stop there. Thy vision's error builds the azure skies. He must give some concrete example. He says, look at the sky. You call it blue, there is no blue. It is dust. It is empty. There is no color of the sky. What has happened? The dust is trapped in the higher atmosphere and it reflects the light in such a way that in your eyes you get the impression of blue color. There is no blue color out there. There is no red color. There is no color, in fact. You are the one who has created color. So he is a scientist also. Gives very nice examples from science. But, you know, he is missing something. But, you know, let's wait for the suspense to build up. So let's not, you know, spoil the suspense. Thy vision's error drew the rainbow's arch. So, you know, sometime back, taking a walk and I heard, you know, there was rain and rainbow. And this line I remembered when two girls passing by exclaimed, "Oh, what a rainbow." I said, death would say this is not real because it will vanish. But this is a mistake. Even in the blue and this, there is something out there which is real. It is taking shapes and forms in the human eye, but there is something which is real, which we don't see it as it is. It's not that there is nothing, because if there is nothing, there cannot be anything. This is a fundamental difference between Shankara's philosophy and Sri Aurobindo. Shankara's philosophy is that the world is not a distortion, but it's an illusion. At least the way it is understood. It's an illusion. That means there is nothing out there, but there is just a seeming, which means that the ultimate truth is nothingness. But Sri Aurobindo says, yes, things are not what they are. But there is something out there and this is a distortion. Now, there is a fundamental difference between the two. If there is illusion, you can do nothing about it. It's an illusion. But if there is a distortion, this can be corrected. So, what we experience in our human state is a distortion of a reality. There is a reality of love, but it's distorted by the human ego and desire. Correct them and true love will emerge. So this is the fundamental difference between these two. But death is here to dissuade us. Thy mortal longings made for thee a soul. Because man wants to be immortal, so he constructs a soul. This angel in thy body thou callest love, who shapes his wings from thy emotions' hues. You know, this too, people say all this bhakti and all his sentimental stuff. Stay away from this. Truth cannot be known by that. It can be known by an impartial inquiry into the nature of things. So I remember once somebody telling this to me. I said, well, impartial inquiry tells me that there is also something called as love in my heart. Whereas, where is that impartiality ever available to any human consciousness? It's much better that we accept that at this point of time, that kind of impartiality, it doesn't exist because we all are born with a certain angle of vision. But that is how it started. It starts. In a foment of thy body has been born, and with the body that housed it, it must die. So love is nothing but a glandular secretion. They've even identified the place. I tell you, it was a tough time. When I joined psychiatry, they told me, don't talk about yoga here. So I said, my God, where have I come? I thought I am going to Rama's Ayodhya. This is Lanka Nagari. So, but Rama has a way. Even in Lanka Nagari, there will be a Vibhishna. So my teacher, who was an outright atheist, but very nice man, he said, I know your interest. You take up yoga, but don't talk about anything. Take up yoga as a cure for drug abuse and things like that. Alcoholism and drug abuse and smoking. I said, all right, no problem. He said, but don't bring anything else. It is strictly asanas. I said, doesn't matter. You have accepted. Later on, whatever I wrote, he was very happy. He said, doesn't matter. So, God always has a way. But this is how the whole, you know, we were taught literally that there is a gland in the brain, you know, there is a secretion of serotonin in the neuron pathways. So when you are in love, actually this serotonin, if you correct the level, you are no more in love. I say it's a very strange kind of thing. So they are confusing the mechanism with the truth. So mechanism is mechanism. It's not the truth. So the engine is not the driver. Even the steam is not the driver. There is something else which is behind it. That death is unable to see. But we can pardon him. He's an ignorant fellow. It is a passion of thy yearning cells. Now he gives the common understanding of love, and which is what we will always hear from the elderly. It is a passion of thy yearning cells. It is flesh that calls to flesh to serve its lust. There is no love. It's just lust. It is a craving of the flesh. And Savitri will give a beautiful reply toward the end, which I am tempted to quote, but let's wait. Let the drama continue. Let's hear out this gentleman. It is thy mind that seeks an answering mind. What you are looking for, you know, calling love is nothing but somebody who can say, yes, you are right. And you also must say in return, yes, you are right. But that is not love. Love is when there is no answering mind and yet there is love. If it's an answering mind, then it is a, you know, a superior and a junior relationship. It's officer and the clerk below who has to say yes. But love is not that. Love is when there is a ultimate difference at every level, yet there is love. That is the power of love. It's a bridge that can heal the gap. But death doesn't understand that. And dreams a while that it has found its mate. A while. As long as there is yes, yes, you are right, it is love. The day you are told, no, you may be wrong, it's no more love. And we see that beautifully in Ramayana. There are two kinds of love shown. One is Ravana, another is Mandodari. So the day Ravana, anybody tells Ravana that, you know, you are no good, you may be wrong, he kicks out. Even his own father-in-law, his brother, he throws out. Because the moment they say you are not right, finished. But look at Mandodari's love. She keeps telling him the path of dharma and yet loves him till the end. That's why she is among the Panch Kanyas, who is regarded as the sacred lady, though she is from her kul born as a Rakshasi. She is an Asur kul Kanya, and yet she is among the five sacred ones, because she always showed to Ravana the path of dharma. That was her duty and that was her expression of love. It is thy life that asks a human prop. What people call love is somebody on whom they can depend, because it's very lonely out there. To uphold its weakness, lonely in the world, or feeds its hunger on another's life. These are all forms of love which are, we may say, that death has distorted love into these forms. This is the figure it has taken, because death governs this world. This is not love. But this is what normally happens. One is looking for someone who can hear out and bear out. A shoulder to lean upon. Somebody whom you can outburden yourself. Or somebody whose heart you can feed upon and feel strong. But none of this is love. But death knows this love very well. And therefore it says that this is what you are calling love. And it's a truth, but not the whole truth of love. A beast thou dreamest immortal, a beast of prey that pauses in its prowl, it crouches under a bush in splendid flower to seize a heart and body for its food. This beast thou dreamest immortal and a god is full of scorn. And there is a truth in it, that there are people who have emotional hunger, just like we have. There are people who have intellectual hunger. So they read lot of books, and they feel that, you know, knowledge will come. Well, knowledge doesn't come by reading books. But they read, they believe that information, sometimes too many books can also create confusion. Whatever little knowledge one has is also lost. You know that story of the man in the boat, and this man is a preacher. So he tells the boatman that, have you read the Gita? He says, no, sir, I had no time. Okay, maybe you are not a Hindu, but you may have read the Bible. No, sir. You see, Bible, very difficult, sir. Okay, have you read the Quran? By the way, are you from Middle East? No, sir. None of these books I have read. He says, you are lost. You are, dead man. So meanwhile, something happens to the boat and water begins to come in. So the boatman turns and says, by the way, sir, do you know swimming? He says, no, I don't. He says, you are a dead man. I'm sorry. You please think about the Gita. I am going and swimming across. So reading books, it's a curiosity. Curiosity is not a seeking. But some people are very happy that they have read so many books. and they have written so many books. But that's not knowledge. Similarly, it's not love, that there is a hunger. Heart is wanting to drop on somebody's emotions, feeds on emotions, so that it may grow strong. So what happens? After a while, it's a small supply after all. And so after a while, you want again, you want again, you want again, and you want again. And there's no end to it. You want to eat away the whole person. But obviously, if the person is a whale, you cannot eat away. But if the person is a small fish, gone. There are people who become absolutely pauperized in their energy. So he says, this is what you are calling love. This is the kind of love that death has created, not the truth of love. This beast thou dreamest, immortal and a god? O human mind, vainly thou torturest an hour's delight to stretch through infinities. Long void and fill its formless, passionless gulfs, persuading the insensible abyss to lend eternity to perishing things. So he says, you know what? I have created these things to ensnare human soul. He doesn't say that because that will give up his game plan. I have created these forms so that human beings can get trapped into the illusion, then get disillusioned and turn away from life. They will declare one day life is not worth living, and either they will come through the door of escape into nirvana, or they will find the nearby revolver and finish themselves. He says, I have created this. He doesn't say it here. But he says, and you think that momentary pleasure, delight, he is using a big word. He doesn't know what delight is, obviously. He says, you are thinking that is will stretch through infinity. No, I have given this momentary pleasure and I am going to take it away. And trickest the fragile movements of thy heart with thy spirits faint of immortality. It's a deception. Faint. A deceptive move. He says that, you are dreaming that this happened and now forever it is going to last. And it's true that some people live in that kind of a dream because they don't know how to discover that true love or how to discover that truth within themselves. So they build a rainbow dream and live in it because that's the most comfortable comfort zone in which they can live. And that's what death will reveal one by one. All here emerges, born from nothingness, encircled at last by the emptiness of space. A while upheld by an unknowing force, then crumbles back into its parent naught. Only the mute alone can forever be. Now you see, he is voicing what great mystics have said. But there is a little twist. That's why there is that famous adage, Shakespeare's, devil quoting the scripture. Scripture in the hands of the devil. Now if you see, death is saying that, all is abolished, there is only the mute. There is a poem of Shubhendu Nirvana where he starts like that. All is abolished save the mute alone. But as he says, Nirvana is a passage towards a greater life. It's not the end of the journey. But death will make it seem that this emptiness is the beginning and end of all things. So this is its game plan, and it's as we can see, speaking, he can really get a nice degree in spiritual studies or religious studies. And then he further adds, only the mute alone can forever be. In the alone, there is no room for love. Very logical. He's an extremely logical fellow. Cunning to the core. If there is only one, how can there be love? Because love means two. Very logical. QED. Of course, there is an answer to it. So, in vain to clothe love's perishable mud, thou hast woven on the immortal's borrowed loom the ideal's gorgeous and unfading robe. It's like somebody would say that, you have given a nice dress to the deity. But this deity itself is made of mud. And after 5 days, you are yourself going to chant Ganpati Bappa and put into the sea. And you think that this dress is beautiful, therefore the deity is immortal. That's how death falsifies the ideal or tries to falsify it. But he doesn't know that the deity doesn't exist in the mud nor in the stone. The deity exists in the human heart. And because he exists in the human heart, therefore he exists in the stone and the mud. Something of this truth is lent to that. And even if it were put back into the sea, still the deity will remain living as a living reality within the human heart. This truth death doesn't know. So he doesn't know that, you know, all the forms and means that human beings have tried are a shadow, a reflection of something else which is inside. The ideal never yet was real made. Then this is the common logic. Show me one sample of transformation. So this is what people ultimately ask. Okay, who is a transformed being? Name one, name two. It's not important. It's not relevant actually at all. Transformed beings are not like museum specimens to be put and displayed. That's not what it is meant to be. Because perhaps if you meet one, you will not recognize. Because we have our conceptions of transformed beings. We have our idea that, you know, transformed human being will be, you know, very sweet and gentle to talk to. But maybe a transformed human being may be very brusque, like Shiva saying, get away. So may wonder what kind of a transformed human being is. But he may be able to see the truth. You know, there are people like this. You know how Nalnida sometimes could suddenly would, somebody knocks at the door, and if he opens, the story is like that, and he would suddenly shut the door, not even saying, yes, what have you come from, sweetly, and just out. Or from a distance, he would tell people, no, go away. Transformed human being. They want to see somebody who can very nicely say, sir, where are you coming from? And if you give a visiting card which says, I am a professor in, so, oh, sir, please, sir, take an honored seat. A transformed human being may do none of these things. People took an offense when Dalai Lama came to visit His Holiness. And Nalnida was in the couch. And somebody was very hurt that he didn't get up when he came. But look at Dalai Lama. It's a true sign of a spiritual being. When he was asked, who do you think after mother could be the successor? Of course, he doesn't know that there is no successor and things like that needed. He's following a Buddhist parampara. He said, why? The secretary, Nalnida, Nalnikant Gupta, he could see that here is somebody who is a realized being. But we expect outer niceties and manners from transformed human beings, but they act according to the truth of the moment seen within a human being, and their actions and ways are very different from what, you know, we imagine it to be. So with this last few lines, we'll stop. Imprisoned in form that glory cannot live. So again, it says that, you know, even if I grant that there is something called as love and light and beauty, the moment it enters into a form, it, see, step by step all the arguments. Into a body shut, it breathes no more. Intangible, remote, forever pure. It's so true. It's very difficult. The gods refused to take birth in a human body when the mother gave them this option. They said, we want to participate and help in the supramental creation. So mother said, okay, will you take a human body? They all said, no, please don't ask. We know what it means to be human. We turn to gods. Gods look up to us. My God, what a tremendous journey these people make. But we think, you know, gods are great. But gods look at human beings and say, we can't take a human body. And then she says, except Krishna. He agreed to tie himself to a human body, and that was to Shurbindo. They said, we'll help from above, but don't ask us to tie, because it means losing. Many great things we lose because human body, human instrumentality is not meant to express divine things. A sovereign of its own brilliant void, unwillingly descends to earthly air to inhabit a white temple in man's heart. In his heart it shines, rejected by his life. He says, I'll tell you the truth, come with me, I'll show you. They will all go inside the temple. So death takes Savitri by the hand, if you may image it, picturize it, and says, see, what are they praying? They are not praying for the deity of love. They are praying for my love, my child, your child. They cannot think beyond. Their lives reject. They are small. They are crammed up. Human consciousness does not accept the supramental. Mother said that we are too small. We have to be vast. We have to be plastic. Then only it can act. So he says, look here. It is there in the heart. Everybody pays a lip service. We all celebrate Shurbindo's birthday, Mother's birthday, the great day, the day of the Lord. But we go back to our small little lives. He says, look here, you are saying, yes, in the heart it is there, but it's rejected by life. Immutable, bodiless, beautiful, grand and dumb, immobile on its shining throne it sits. Dumb it receives his offering and his prayer. It has no voice to answer to his call, no feet that move, no hands to take his gifts. So he says, all this ideal love, flawless happiness is a construct of your mind. Even if I grant that something of it is there, okay, in the human heart, human life doesn't accept it. The human body is too limited. The human life is too cramped up. Human consciousness is so small. It cannot, that ideal can never establish itself upon earth. It is just hanging in the void. All right, you pray, but there is none who answers to this prayer. There is in fact no God. If he is there, he is impersonal. He has nothing to do with your heart and your prayers. So that's why we have to be very careful. There are all kinds of things that happen and people are very happy that so and so is just believing in God. It's not enough. Even death believes in God. But his God is a God who is a God of void. He is nothingness. He is an embodiment of that vacant space. Whereas the God that Mother and Aurobindo bring out is the one, he's the being with whom we can relate, we can connect. My God is love and sweetly suffers all. And that's why we have that beautiful poem, Krishna, where Aurobindo makes it very clear. Oh, no void absolute. He says, don't think that he's just a void. Red lips, hands that hold and clasp, red lips that kiss and blow the float. That is God. So we'll stop here and continue after 5-7 minutes. 6:20 we'll continue.